Thank you for keeping it urban. We hope you're keeping it safe. We hope you're sanitizing. We hope you're wearing your mask. We hope you're social distancing because we need you alive. COVID is real and it does kill. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and tonight on The Checkpoint, we are going to be checking ourselves as young people. We are going to be checking our grooming and personal development. And it's an exciting edition because I have a young person at just 25. She has authored two prose and poetry books. She's engaged in a lot of social initiatives. Claire, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Nicholas. I'm glad to be here.
Claire Muge, who are you in brief?
Well, I am an author, like you said. I have published two books. I am young. I'm a young person, like you can see. I am a psychologist. I am a leader. I love young people. I love leadership. I'm passionate about developing young people. And my goal as a person is to inspire young people, to help them reach their utmost, you know, potential. So that's a little bit of who I am. I'm a leader. I'm an author. I'm a psychologist. I am a motivational speaker sometimes. So I'm a lot of things, but yeah, that's really who I am.
Maybe to be a bit precise, school background, when you say you are a psychologist, someone would be interested in knowing what did you study at school?
Well, I studied community psychology. I have a bachelor's degree in community psychology, and I am pursuing a master of science in clinical psychology. So I went to Trinity College Nabingo for O-level. And then I went to Iganga SS for A-level. I studied literature, history, economics. And then when I came to campus, I pursued community psychology. I initially wanted to do law like everyone else, you know. Went to law school, passed the pre-entry. But somewhere along the way, I started questioning myself and wondering, was this just like a dream for everyone else, you know? Everyone who does literature, who is part of the debate club, who is, you know, part of the journalism club, somehow has to find a way into law school, someone somehow has to find a way into journalism school. But is this really the path that, you know, is for me? Because I wanted to help people. And I kept wondering, as a lawyer, will I be able to actually help people the way I want to? Will I be able to grow them, you know? And I don't think I saw that very clearly in the path of law and in the path of journalism. But with psychology, you know, I was going to be interacting with people, I was going to be doing counseling, I was going to be helping people, building them. And I felt that was a better path for me. So, yeah, I decided to pursue community psychology.
About the age of 18, 19, 20, when you're joining university, yes. you're young, you're excited about life, but you're not very sure of what life really is. Yes. So sometimes that's a very hard decision to make. Career path, it's very hard. I'll tell you, in the newsroom today, you will still find people that are over 40 and are still debating on whether they should continue being journalists or they should go and do law or do something else. While elsewhere in the world, you would find a writer that is as old as my editor, Mr. John Kakande, but they are still reporting. Here, after 5 years of practicing journalism, people want to take off. Of course, there are economic bits of it, but how, the question then is, how do you have a clear mind at a tender age when life is exciting, when you think you can achieve anything fancy that you want to be? How do you have that clear distinction that, well, this is the path I want to take?
Well, I think having that clear distinction comes with trying out. So I think that for so many young people, they start trying out different things at a later age. So when someone comes to campus is when they now have the freedom to start trying out this, start trying out the other. But remember that when you've come to campus, you're already pursuing a certain course. Your career is already being shaped in a certain angle. Now imagine if you had started exploring sports, you know, all those different things while you were still in high school, started exploring, do I want to be an author? What does it look like to be a lawyer, you know? And with the guidance of, your parents, your guardians, your teachers, people that are really inspiring you, like giving you a picture of what it looks like to be a lawyer, giving you a picture of what it looks like to be an engineer, so that you don't have to now start exploring when you reach campus. Because imagine you've reached campus, you're reading engineering school, and then you're like, wait, I'm not sure. What if I actually want to be a lawyer? But imagine finishing engineering school 3 years down, 4 years, I think, down the road, and then you come back, do the pre-entry, begin law school, and then you have to go to LDC. And then, man, you know? So if they had started exploring early, finding what does it look like to be an engineer? Can I go and spend, let's say, a week with an engineer uncle? Your parents could be knowing people that are engineers. So go and spend like a week in their office looking at what it's like to be an engineer. And then you're like, because I feel that there's something that resonates with who you are, it will not click. If who you are is not an engineer, it will not click. You can't explain how. You might know how to do the engineering work. You may seem to enjoy it, but something inside you doesn't feel right. And then like, okay, let's try journalism. Or do you know anyone at New Vision? Oh yeah, let me go and spend a day there. Look at the cameras. Look at what people are saying. I'm like, do I like it? Yes. Of course you are, but you're exploring. Now, by the time you reach campus, you're able to say, I looked at what it's like to be a lawyer. I didn't like it. I looked at what it's like. You're making an informed decision. You know, you have a bigger picture. But now for many young people, the challenge is they don't explore. They explore late. So they reach campus and it's too late to start making certain decisions, and they are scared. And then you're like, you know what? My parents are paying school fees. I mean, they are hustling to get this money. So let me just go with it. And then you wake up 5 years down the road and you're like, Daddy, here is your degree. I'm now going to pursue.
I want to be a dancer.
Yes, I want to be a dancer. And you're thinking, I wish, you know, I look at young people and I wish they could have started when they were like 6, 10, you know, started exploring.
Yeah, that very point, yes. You start, you're saying it's important that someone starts exploring, a child starts exploring, yes, what they want to be in life at an early age.
Yes, yes,
but
yes.
The question then is, does our education system provide that flexibility? Does our social setting provide that flexibility to explore what we could probably be the best we can be?
Well, I think at the moment it doesn't so much. I think what I experienced as a young person has been that this was on the onus of my teachers and my lecturers, people that really believed in me, trying to push me in certain directions, saying, oh, hey, Claire, there's this training here, you could try it out, maybe you might like it. But I feel that the education system, from being on the receiving end, not from, you know, being on the decision making end, but being a student, being someone who actually looks at, you know, lecturers and receives from them, that so many people come and do what they are supposed to do without much care of where am I taking these students. Say they are studying, they want to be psychologists, but am I just teaching them or am I actually helping them, you know, explore what they actually want to be? Because I feel that some courses, say at campus, or even some combinations in school, you can almost be anything. You can do something like, say, PEM. And you have a wide range of career paths you can explore. But there is very little being told to you about career paths. So most of what we receive in terms of career is from people that have followed a certain career path. Say we are in high school, we are doing hell, head, and all these combinations. And then our teachers, out of, you know, the goodness of their heart, or let's say the HM or the school administration, decides to bring someone to come and speak to us. But the person who comes to speak to us is a lawyer. So in our heads, what is the image we have of our path is lawyer. We don't have you can be this, you can be this, you can be anything, you know, you can still be a doctor, like you can be anything. Okay, not a doctor, yes, but you can be anything with what you've studied. And I feel that that is something that we need to change, because it's not just about us studying, finishing, you know, that, okay, yes, go to school, get a job, get married, have children, build a house, you know. I feel that young people these days are looking to have an impact. Like, how many people do I have an impact on? Yes, I go to office every day. Yes, I have a job, but do I actually have an impact on people? Am I changing lives? Those are the things that people are actually passionate about. So if we can direct them in ways that help them explore, but also give them a wide range, you know, of possibilities, telling you, so yes, you've studied psychology, but what you're passionate about is, say, being a radio presenter. How do you turn the skills that you have in psychology to help you as a radio presenter, because you probably have the passion, but you can't ride on passion alone. You need some skills. So you know you have people skills, you have good interpersonal skills. So how do you turn that to help you as, you know, as a radio presenter and things like that? So you're transferring what you probably studied as a psychologist into, I'm a dancer and I work with people. I love dancing. So how do I transfer what I learned as a, you know, as an engineer into being a camera person, something like that?
As a motivational speaker, I was going to ask you about something about passion, but yeah. Good, you've mentioned it. Yeah. So it gives us a chance to move on. Probably you could help us paint a picture of what was Claire like, what was your childhood like growing up?
Well, my childhood growing up was a bit quiet. I was a bit of a quiet child. I grew up with my dad and a sister and siblings. Growing up was very quiet, so I took a lot of solace in reading. My parents were literature teachers, so I started reading at a young age. I remember I read Charles Dickens books when I was like in P4. So by the time I got to Form 6, I was like, you guys, I read these books, you know, when I was a child. So I used to read a lot. I used to really read a lot. So my childhood comprised a lot of reading, a bit of reciting. My mom was a poet, so she used to write poems and I used to recite them here and there at this teacher's gathering, at this function and things like that. Besides that, I think that's really pretty much. I can't remember so much about, of course, yeah, there were those funny moments of, yeah, get caned here. I wasn't much of a stubborn child, but I think I am quietly stubborn. Like this stubborn that will not make noise, but read your books and have these ideas in your mind. And when someone tells you, oh, you should do this, you're like, no, but you'll not tell them anything. You'll just be there, you know, quiet in your own angle. And yes, that kind of stubborn. So that was really pretty much it.
In 2016, you, when I was reading, when I was preparing for yes. you, some of the internet yes. things that came up. In 2016, you graduated as the best peer educator yes. with Richer Hand Uganda. Yes. Tell us about that.
Well, I worked with Richer Hand Uganda as a peer educator, and I love helping people. I went there. I was a volunteer with them as a peer educator for about 2 years or 3 years or even more, and I went there to help people. So because my heart was to help people, I went and did my best, you know. I didn't go there for anything else other than to help people. That's my passion. That's really who I am. So wherever we went, I had something that I wanted to do more than everyone else. I wanted to feel like, okay, yes, we've achieved this target. Our target when we came to this school was to make sure these young people get this. But I kept feeling like, I want to leave my mark as me, as Claire. I want to leave my mark. And I was just doing it. And I didn't know anyone was noticing, you know. So a year down the road, I was awarded Best Female Peer Educator for 2015-2016. And I was shocked. I think it built who I was, because I think sometimes you downplay yourself. You look and you don't think you're that good, you know. And some of these things come to validate, you know, who you are. It's like you've been doing this and you're like, yeah, I'm just doing this. I'm just doing what I love. Nothing big. And then it's a big deal out there. So I think it was a really special moment for me, because it built who I am. It built my confidence, my esteem. Yes.
Best peer educator. Then one would wonder, have you through life been the best at everything that you've been doing?
Well, I am excellent. I am very, very excellent. I try to make sure that everything that I do it to the best of my ability. So I think I've kind of been excellent. I mean, through high school, through primary, of course, best student a few times here and there, being among the best in class, but also knowing that being the best student isn't just about passing, isn't just about the grades, being a prefect. Like, I think I've been a bit of excellence. Excellence has marked, you know, so many of my milestones through high school. Even at campus, I was among the best students. I graduated at top of my class. So I think it hasn't really been that I want to be the best. It's something like, it's who I am. Like, I can't do any less. I just have to do the best When I come, I give it 100%. That's really who I am.
So you should then use that opportunity to also tell us about your MasterCard helping Karamoja Girls project.
Well, so I have a friend of mine who is really passionate about teenage pregnancy. So she started this organization called Dash for Girls. And when she started the organization, actually, we were in campus. We were both MasterCard scholars. And we were really exploring, what do we do? One thing that we've both been passionate about is helping people. She was also part of Richer Hand. After I joined Richer Hand, she also joined after me. And we were passionate about helping people. And we also had another friend who was from Karamoja, because the MasterCard program helps people from disadvantaged communities. So we decided, why not explore what it's like for teenage, you know, girls out there, and then try to help them, you know, stay in school, try to help them with things like sexual reproductive health, try to help them with menstrual hygiene, things that actually affect them, because you find that some of those girls are not able to go to school because they are pregnant. But even before they get pregnant, sometimes they are body shamed because, you know, of their menstrual cycle. So there are a lot of challenges that keep them from going to school, and knowing that some of the things, I don't want to say all the things, but some of the things, it's hard to escape the fact that some of the things we have and who we are is because we actually went to school. But these people don't have the chance to go to school. So can we give them that opportunity? Can we take away those things that would stop them from going to school? I can't go to school for 1 week because I'm on my period. I can't go to school because probably I'm being married off and I can't say no. Like those challenges, those unsaid challenges that prevent them from going to school. So that's something that we were passionate about. The project is still ongoing right now in Karamoja. I'm not very much a part of it now, but it's still ongoing, and yes.
Why wouldn't you be part of such a wonderful project?
Well, it's not that I wouldn't want to be part of it. I think that not exactly that along your journey of life, as you discover who you are, there are things that you sort of step out of. Like, you're still a part of it, but not at the core. So say right now, there are people like my lecturers. They are still a part of my life, you know, but they are not at the core of my life. So the path I am taking and the path different people are taking pushes you away, you know, a little, as you streamline who you are. So when I stepped out, it was because my interests as a person started growing and changing. I became more interested in leadership. So I am still part of the project, yes, but not at the very core.
All right. So we are going to talk a bit about your work, the authoring bit.
Yes.
Before you, there was pain. That's the first line you use in your first stanza of Night and Rose.
Yes.
Why?
Well, I think there's a lot of heartbreak that almost so many young people experience exploring love, you know, relationships here and there. So before you really find what your heart settles for, there's usually a lot of pain. Pain, sometimes pain from just past relationships, sometimes pain from disappointment. So it's like you find this person and it's like they take away a load off your back. So it's like you look at them and the first thing that comes to your mind is, before I met this person, there was so much pain. And it's not like, I can't even explain it, because it's not like they wake up and then they come and take it off your back, but it's just like being with them takes a load off you. And that's really what Night and Rose is about. It's a love story.
Is Night and Rose poetry or prose, or
it's just poetry.
It's a mix and match.
It's just poetry.
You dedicate Night and Rose to your husband, who you say has loved you so well.
Yes.
But going now to the second stanza, you say, the first time came sweet words of lust, glazed with love.
Yes. Yes.
So I want to connect a bit of dots.
Yes.
From the first line, before there's pain, then you dedicate the book to your husband, and then you go ahead to describe what love feels like.
Yes.
Is this personal about you, or is it just about life and love?
I think it's a bit personal. I would like to disappoint everyone out there who thinks that writers write fiction. We really don't write fiction. We do, but a lot of what we portray as fiction has a little bit of our pieces of us in there. So Night and Rose is a story of two lovers. you know. So the lady, the lady really writes to the gentleman, and then the gentleman writes to the lady, and then, you know, they match it up together and something like that. So part of it was what I experienced, because you find that looking back, a lot of what we called love was not really love. It was, like it says in the book, lust, you know, glazed with sweet words. So it's more or less lust that is portraying itself as love. So it's like I took the readers on a journey of what it is like before you actually settle, and what it is like to have the fears of settling with the person that you want to settle with, because you've had lust glazed with love, and now you're having real love, and you're not sure what the distinction really is, and sometimes you're scared. I mean, your heart has been broken here, your heart has been broken there, and you're like, should I really entrust my heart to someone else? So it's like that experience of lust glazed with love, and then if you progress, it comes down to this person finally saying, yes, I will give myself, you know, to this person. And then the gentleman also giving his experience of how he saw the girl, how he liked the girl, and things like that, and how he finally is privileged, you know, to have this girl say yes to him, and then finally together, you know, they're happily ever after, and something like that.
But you said it's not all fiction. It's yes. it's purely about you.
Purely, just
a little bit about you.
Yes.
But and of course the theme of love comes out so strongly.
Yes.
But in that theme, are there lessons that a young person out there can pick about from this theme?
I think that one of the lessons that I want young people to learn, especially in terms of love, is that you can't run away from it. Because of the heartbreaks and the things that have gone wrong, it's like everyone is trying to make sure I don't fall in love again. And yet, it's almost inevitable to fall in love. It's almost inevitable to let people in. Like,
The Bible says, guard your heart.
Yes, guarding your heart doesn't mean not letting people in, you know. So I think that when young people finally come to terms with the fact that love is love and love is going to be a part of you, they stop running away from it. So I wrote Night and Rose to inspire people to love again. Like, I feel that people's hearts sometimes grow cold to love. And they shut people out and they're like, no, I'm not letting anyone in. But there is a part of you that wants to love. You may not admit it, but there's a part of you that actually wants to love, that wants to give people a chance. So this book was for me an inspiration to them to love again, sharing like a story that will inspire them to fall in love, that will inspire them to open their hearts, you know, to love. So
before we leave this subject, I'm going to delve a bit into controversy.
Yes.
You're married at 25.
Yes.
Which I would say is it's not a young age, but it's tender.
Yes.
And I would confess my fiancé is about your age.
Yes.
So, but there is one pattern that I've realized over the years as we study the subject love.
Yes.
Is so many people after university immediately, like almost my entire journalism
yes.
class, people are getting married so fast. So I'm wondering, but then the rate of breakups is equally high.
Yes.
Actually, it's
yes.
even higher.
Yes.
So I'm wondering, don't you fear, like I fear, that probably we are getting into relationships for the wrong reasons?
I think some people, yes, some people are chasing a goal, you know, like I mentioned earlier, finish school, get married, have children, blah, 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 you know, and that's really the pattern that they are chasing. So it's like, now that I've finished school, the next step is get married.
Isn't that what our parents tell us?
Well, I'm glad my parents didn't tell me that. My father didn't. It's not a goal like finish this. It's about you meet the person that you want to spend the rest of your life with. And then you're like, yes, I want to spend the rest of my life waking up next to this person. Let's take it to the next level. I'm ready to commit to them. Not because I've reached a certain age and yo, I'm supposed to get married, or because this person has asked me to marry them and I'm scared to say no, so now I have to get married, or because all my friends are getting married, so now I need to get married. Most of my friends are actually not married, you know. So I think that so many people are chasing a goal, and you're right, they're in relationships for the wrong reasons, because of the glamour that comes with a beautiful wedding. So many people are chasing that, and then you wake up 1 month down the road and the wedding is over, the marriage is looking at you in the face, and you're like, okay, I don't think this is what I wanted, you know. So
talking about chasing a goal, have you realized for most people our age, many of them, that the pictures that we post on social media of our graduations, yes, of us going for further, yes, studies, are not as many as the pictures that we post about either Kuchala,
yes,
or Kwanjula,
yes,
or the weddings. Yes. What informs this? Why is it a social setting? Have we been wired to think that the end goal of life is getting married? What exactly is happening?
I think we've been a bit socialized that way, because we see that happen to people. Yes, I feel that so many people get married right after school. Like, after school, you get a job, and it's almost like, for so many people, the next thing you're waiting for is getting married, because it's all so many of your relatives are asking about. You go for the Thanksgiving party, Christmas, and when are you getting married? Oh, we saw you posted a picture with this man. Oh, is he the one? And, you know, things like that. And that pressure, it puts pressure on people, you know, to do things that they probably shouldn't. But also because when you fall in love, there's like a picture that you see, an image of happily ever after. And there are certain steps that you must take to get to that picture. And part of those steps include, you know, Kuchala, getting married, and things like that. And also because it's really a happy moment. So you find so many people flaunting it. Like, it's a beautiful thing to look forward to. You know, it's love. It brings together families. I mean, it brings together two families from different walks of life. So it's a beautiful thing to look forward to. So I think that socially, there's a lot of marriage, like, you know, love, that you see people getting married, and you also wish the same for yourself. But also because it's really the end goal of love. Like,
I mean, so what?
Well, it's the end goal of love, but yes. And I agree with you entirely.
Yes.
But then my question is about aspirations. Should people not feel pressurized that they haven't yet probably gone for further studies, or they haven't started something that is personal in terms of development, but all they fight for all their life, and at the end of the day, sometimes it ends into meeting,
yes,
the wrong people,
yes,
it,
yes,
ends into violence.
Yes.
Is it,
yes,
all, is life really all about love and marriage, other than any other thing? I mean, if I rear dogs, that's an accomplishment,
yes,
for,
yes,
me. Why shouldn't society appraise me,
yes,
for rearing good breeds of,
yes,
dogs? Why should they have to wait,
yes,
for my wedding?
Yes, I think that society is changing, like you said. So many people are doing things that are out of the normal, and society is never really going to appraise them for that. I feel that people should do what makes them happy. If you feel that what you want to do that will make you happy is getting married, get married. If, of course, it is with the right person, you know, you found love and all that. If you feel that you don't want to get married, you want to go and continue studies. If you feel that you want to start a business, like, I feel that what makes people happy is really pushed to the back, and what other people think should make you happy, what other people think you should be doing, is what people are doing at the moment. So you find that there are people that are okay sitting at home and being a housewife, and that's what they want, and it's totally fine. And there are people who are thinking like, oh my God, no, I can't just sit at home. I have to get a job. I have to run a business. And that's also fine. Like, do that, you know. There are people that are like, I don't think I'm ready to settle down yet. I think I'll settle down after maybe I've gotten a job, I've finished my master's, I've done this. That is also okay. I think that especially young people out there need to stop looking for validation in society. Like, do what makes you happy. Remember, at the end goal, you're going to get married, and then what? You're going to make everyone happy, and then what? You're going to get the job. Imagine your parent or someone, you know, tells you, oh yeah, there's this job at New Vision. You get the new job at New Vision. You cry every morning before coming to work. What's that for, you know? So do what makes you happy. If you feel that you want to go back to school, go back to school. Like, you have to come to a point in time where everyone else becomes silent, and the only voice you listen to is your heart.
Claire, when we return, we shall talk a bit about the girl that was. You're still watching The Checkpoint. Let's break.